to introduce you on this occasion. I take it as a privilege to introduce you. Soumya Sharma is an assistant professor in the Department of Linguistics at EFLU Lucknow campus, India. She was a guest faculty at the IIT Kanpur for a year, where she taught a course on composition and communication skills. Her research interests include examining the discourse psychology interface, particularly gender issues, vocabulary, teaching, and critical pedagogy. She has published in the areas of English language teaching, stylistics, and critical discourse analysis. Some of her research publications include Discourse and Psychology, An Introduction, and the Routledge in the 2020 year it was published, and Language, Gender, Ideology is a Construction of a Femininity for Marriage. Routledge publication, it was published in 2018. And Common Errors in Everyday English, it was published in 2017. Yeah, thank you for giving me this opportunity, ma'am. And I welcome. So far we conducted 21 webinars from Alta Telangana. This is the 22nd webinar. We welcome you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for this warm welcome, and thank you for inviting me to be a speaker for the webinar hosted by Alta Telangana. I have been teaching in the Department of Linguistics at EFLU Lucknow for 10 years. And I have a total teaching experience of more than 12 years. And as I was introduced, most of my research interests are in language and in psychology. Language in terms of discourse, and also in English language teaching. So today I'm going to share with you some of the inputs that I have studied and known from different researchers from all over the world on how to be an excellent teacher in the class, and how to hold the students' interest. Now, as we understand, teaching is an intensely psychological process. And to make the lesson engrossing, we need the expertise of the tutor. And we also need to create some very meaningful contexts of learning. For this to happen, obviously, we need to look at the psychology of the teacher, the psychology of the student, and my personal understanding is to look at the psychology of... One second, please. Sorry for the interruption. And to look at the psychology, like I was saying, to look at the psychology of the student, the psychology of the teacher, and the language and psychology aspect. This is my... feeling that language and psychology should also needs to be looked at. So in this talk, I am going to talk about some of the problems that teachers face, the effective attitudes and the strategies and techniques that they can develop for teaching, and also the student problems, some of the student problems, and how to deal with those issues. And also the aspect of language and psychology, which is both related to the teacher and to the student. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we need to look at a kind of an attitudinal shift, not only in terms of how the teacher speaks and delivers a lecture or his lecture, but also in terms of how the student reacts and responds to that lecture. So there is an attitudinal change that is required, not just for the teacher, but also for the student. before we begin with the effective teaching attitudes, these are some of the problems that teachers face. One of them is something which in psychology we call as dissonance. That is, difference between their beliefs and difference between actual practice. For example, some teachers might believe in certain kinds of thought systems, belief systems, but they may not be able to practice them openly in the classroom. Why? Because a classroom context requires a certain way of functioning, a certain way of behaving, a certain way of talking. Also, the second point is, most of us as teachers, we believe that we are information providers. We are teaching. Teaching is as a way of providing information to the student. But as we understand, in our present COVID context, because of the outbreak of this pandemic, most of our teaching has become online. And a lot of the information can be accessed by online. So we are not just, we need to bring about
Hello. Hello, Vinay sir.
So instead of looking at the student's failure only in terms of their background, it is a holistic context. We need to look at the student, we need to look at the related to this is the aspect of evaluation. Evaluation in most of our Indian schools and colleges is seen in terms of achievement. It is not seen in terms of learning. And this is something that needs to change. We need to, obviously, evaluation needs to be achievement oriented. If students need to crack exams, competitive exams, but ultimately the evaluation needs to be learning directed. That is, the evaluation needs to look at how much the learner has learned, what are they interested in learning, and how can we help them to learn what they are interested in learning within the framework of the curriculum and even a little outside that. Last but not the least is one of the problems we face is our own working conditions, long working hours, you know, the kind of setup we work in, the corrections, the classes, all of that. Now, keeping in view these problems, we also have two basic methods for teaching. These are, the first is the direct transmission method, and the second is called the constructivist method. The direct transmission method looks at teachers as information providers. It is teacher-centric, and what is valued is that the metaphor of the student as a conduit, that is, the student is a conduit that is supposed to be filled with information. And we as teachers are supposed to give that information to the student. Obviously, in this kind of a context, in this method or approach, silence is extremely valued. It is normally considered that a good teacher is someone whose class is silently functioning, who's able to manage noise in their class. Right? And a good teacher is also someone who teaches facts to students, who elicits clear, precise answers from the students. In contrast to this is another method, which is the constructivist method. The constructivist method focuses on meaning construction, how meaning is constructed in the classroom, in the interaction between the teacher and the student. Here, the teacher is not an information provider, but the teacher is a facilitator. And obviously, the learners have a little more autonomy. And most importantly, in this second approach, basic life skills, critical life skills, like developing the student's social quotient, developing the student's emotional quotient, apart from their IQ, right, is extremely important. Also, what is important in this method is, or this approach, is that the fact that student is supposed to, teachers encourage the way students talk, the way they question, the way they think, right? And try to develop their critical skills, critical thinking skills, how they reason, how they summarize, and things like that. Now, as a teacher, I feel looking at our Indian context and the problems that we as teachers face, we cannot have either of these methods. But somewhere, as a teacher, we need to be flexible. In some classes, we should have teacher-centric approach. In some classes, we can have the constructivist approach, which is a little more learner-centric. For example, one practical suggestion is, and I'm sure most of the teachers would be doing this also in their classes, that when we are lecturing, that particular aspect of lecturing, explaining, is teacher-centric. But when we are asking questions, trying to assess whether our learners have learned things, we should adopt different ways, different methods, different media to understand the way they've learned things and how much they have learned and how to assess them exactly. For example, we can use technology, we can use multimedia, we can use different platforms, online platforms. We can also use different genres of learning, like asking them to make a presentation or be a part of a debate, or is it oral speaking? Is it a question answer method? Is it in the form of a narrative or storytelling? So there are multiple ways in which we can construct meaning and help them to learn further. So the emphasis is always on flexibility. The teacher is supposed to decide and gauge which of these approaches works in which of their classes. Because this is not just restricted to English language teaching. This actually applies to teachers who are teaching all kinds of subjects. Teachers teaching social studies, history, geography, mathematics, science. So these two approaches apply to both. After this, we would move on to the ways in which teachers can develop particular attitudes. But before we talk about different kinds of attitudes, we need to understand that broadly in research, attitude is understood as a stable schematic construct. Stable schematic construct means attitudes are stable. They don't change very easily. Schematic is derived from the word schema. Schema here means that there are certain ideas we have about the world, about people in the world, about the way events and things happen in the world. And these ideas over time become stable. For example, one example that I often use in my classes is when if I want to do an icebreaker session with my students, I often ask them what according to them is a good teacher. I often ask them this to understand their attitude so that I can also process that information and teach accordingly. Most of the students give me these kinds of replies. They tell me that, you know, a teacher is supposed to be knowledgeable. The teacher is supposed to be well-dressed. The teacher is supposed to speak in a particular way, right? These are schemas, certain set ideas that students have about teachers. Like students have ideas, we teachers also have set ideas about students and about teachers and teaching. So here we are going to look at some of the effective schematic attitudes, the schemas that help a teacher to teach well and also help the student to understand that this particular teacher is well, teaching well, and so I need to pay attention in the classroom. There has been a lot of research, and some of the research I've cited here, for example, research by Richards and Rogers and by Richard, and most of the research pertains to teachers in service and also teachers who are training to become full-time teachers. So one of the basic attitudes for effective teaching is a spectrum from kind to disapproving things. Obviously, most students value teachers who are show genuine care, concern, and respect and kindness towards the student. Students would not tend to value teachers who intimidate or disapprove too much. For example, I know of a particular colleague in another university who is extremely So, attitude in every classroom for all this. One approach fits all would not work here. We have differently with students. We have to deal differently with students that come from, let's say, an English medium background or a regional medium background, or students that come from different socioeconomic statuses, right? Because students in the class are, after all, students. And we as teachers need to focus on their diversity so that we can, in a way, pay attention to other kinds of social issues which are, believe me, very important to students. Like, how is it that other students are responding to them? What is their interaction in the class? Are they being bullied? Are they being mocked? Are they being made fun of in the class? So as a teacher, if we show some kind of kindness towards them and pay attention to their diversity, we can deal with this psychologically. And obviously, it increases our respect in front of the student. And the students do tend to value us. Another aspect is the aspect of responsibility sharing. In a classroom, in most of our classes, we feel that we are the teacher. So we are lecturing. And the students are the ones who will get the information from us. Obviously, somewhere at the back of our minds, as teachers, we feel we know more than students, which is rightly so. That is why we are in the profession. We know much more than students, and we're supposed to know much more than students. But more important is, we need to have a kind of responsibility sharing. We need to make the student realize in the class, through our lectures, through the activities, through our questions, multiple ways, that the student is equally responsible as we are for the conduct of the class. We need to make the student responsible and to make the student understand through either individual work or group work that the student is accountable for their behavior, for their classroom performance, and for their academic achievement. So responsibility needs to be shared equally between the student and the teacher. Also, an aspect which I would deal a little later is motivation for learning. This is something that as teachers, we've all heard, we need to motivate our students to learn. But when I would deal with students' problems, we would understand that there are different kinds of motivations. And we need to focus on those different kinds of motivations and how we can do that. The next aspect is creativity. Creativity or what we would say as out-of-the-box thinking or a lateral thinking approach is very important in the class. Why? Because we will often see that students, when we come and lecture and explain and do that repeatedly day in and day out in the class, students would not tend to respond. Most students have very short attention spans. Psychologically, research shows that they have less attention spans. And when it comes to an activity like teaching, obviously, many of our students are not extremely motivated. It is our job as teachers to motivate them. So obviously, we need to be creative in the classroom. So we can engage the students' interests and bring them to focus on particular activities. One way of doing this is, there are two points that I've mentioned. The use of multiple intelligences and identifying the learning patterns. Now, the use of Gardner worked on the concept of intelligence, and he found out that intelligence is not just academic intelligence. Intelligence is related to multiple things. For example, it can be related to the way we speak, verbal intelligence. It can be related to kinesics, the body movement, facial gestures, etc. It can be related to visuals. It can be related to music. It can be related to listening, oral. So when we identify these kinds of aspects, it can be related to social interaction or the use of emotions that are healthy for learning. So we need to identify these intelligences, and we also need to identify the different learning patterns in students. A small activity that I often do in my classes, after one or two ice-breaking sessions where I discuss different things with them, different concepts like where have they come from, what do they like watching movies and things like that. I often ask them veiled indirect questions related to, you know, how do you study? Do you like pictures and studying? Are you more of a listener? How many of you like speaking? And things like this. How do you listen to different kinds of music? What kind of music do you like listening to? So through this, I'm able to assess to some extent the learning pattern of the student. And then I cultivate and I frame particular activities for them. So if I'm doing a group activity, I will have activities based on images, activities based on speaking, activities where they have to, you know, use songs, right? Songs of their choice, right? Activities based on drama, movement, kinesics, right? So that all the students, different types of students, can be included in such activities. And they can understand the topic, obviously in different ways, but they are able to understand the topic. Another aspect is the use of verbal and non-verbal communication. Many a times when we speak to the students, one aspect that as teachers we should remember is when we are lecturing in the class, we need to make eye contact with everybody, each and every student. The student who is the brightest, the student who is the dullest in the class. We need to make eye contact with everybody. And in my experience, I have seen that when I make contact with the dullest student in the class, right, they get a feeling that ma'am is paying attention. And because ma'am is paying attention, I need to sit straight. Because ma'am is paying attention, I should stop fidgeting. Because ma'am is paying attention, I need to open my eyes. So when we give attention to the student, when we show interest in them, the students will respond. So this is one way of why I'm making appropriate non-verbal communication. Another one is, I often, tend to pat students on my back or smile or nod when they're giving the correct answer. Even when they're giving a partially correct answer, I tend to respond with appropriate non-verbal cues so that they know that they are being heard in the class, right? Sometimes some of my students give completely incorrect and funny replies. I even respond to those. Even though I am firm, I might respond to one or two students, I might nod, and then I might turn around and say, we understand, but this is not the answer. Can someone else give another answer? So we are responding to them, but we are also correcting them at the same time. So use of particular verbal and non-verbal communication cues are very, very important. And obviously we need to understand their beliefs and their expectations, what they expect from a class. Some other points that can help us to develop effective teaching attitudes is the classroom dynamics. That is, how is it that the tables and chairs or the desks in the classroom are arranged? Sometimes, if I'm giving a lecture, my students sit in rows in terms of the arrangement of their chairs and tables. But if I'm doing an activity, when the class begins, I often tell my students, before we start the class, there is a 5 minutes of physical exercise for you. We are all going to change the way our tables and chairs are arranged. And we rearrange that in the form of a semicircle or in the form of small groups so that they are slightly excited. They don't feel that, oh God, again, we have to come to a class. Again, we're going to sit in the same place. Again, we're going to focus on, you know, the same topics. So there has to be small activities that we do with them, 2 minute, 3 minute, 5 minute activities, does change their mood psychologically and will make them a little more alert in the classroom. Another aspect is, I always move around and lecture in the classroom. Movement of the teacher is very important. Why? Because if the student feels that the teacher sits on the chair and speaks, the back benchers, the front benchers might pay attention, the back benchers will not. So movement becomes very important for the teacher. Some other aspects are, when we're asking them questions, we should rephrase them if the students find them difficult. We should repeat our questions and we should acknowledge their replies, something that I just said, discussed 2 minutes back. One example that I can give you is of a school teacher from my middle school, my secondary education, was an English teacher of mine. And this is not a very positive memory that I have. But from her behavior, I learned that I should not do this. The memory was, she was an excellent teacher and was very knowledgeable in the subject. But when it came to questioning, she would ask questions and not wait for some time for the student to reply. So ours was a mixed ability classroom. Some of us were very bright, some of us were average, and some of us were just not interested in studying. So I could see very clearly that we used to sit in the front benches. So we would respond very quickly. But then the ones who were sitting in the back would take some time to understand and respond. And by that time, she would have gone to the next 2-3 questions. So the student who had developed some interest to answer would actually lose all interest because of not acknowledging the answers or not giving them answer time, even when they're fumbling. So this is something that I learned, that when I ask questions in my class, I give them literally 30 seconds. 30 seconds is a long amount of time. Normally, research shows that we as teachers do not wait for even 10 seconds. But sometimes I give them 30 seconds. Take your time, think about it, give me an answer. This means that even the student sitting at the back will have a chance to respond. They might not respond for all the 10 questions I ask. But if they respond for 3 questions, 4 questions, some of my work is done. I'm able to develop some kind of interest in the class for that student. Also, we need to encourage students in terms of this phrase that is used in academics. It's called academic risk taking. This means that we need to encourage students to think and to speak loudly that they do not understand the question, that the question should be repeated. The concept needs to be repeated. And I start off by usually acknowledging and saying that I am taking this lecture. I have prepared the lecture extensively. I will tell you all the information that I know. But there are some things that I don't know as a teacher. And I am ready to acknowledge that I do not know this. So after the lecture, if you have questions, please ask. If there is something that you add to the lecture, it's going to be very great. I always do that. So if I am showing risk-taking, if I am showing that as a teacher, I do not have an ego, I am open to them, I am open to their suggestions, their inputs, surely they will also respond back to me. And usually in my classes, they do tend to respond. And we create a healthy atmosphere, that fosters learning. An aspect which I had discussed is interdependence. The next one is interdependence and individual accountability. This means through our activities, either individual activities, tests, assignments, or interdependent activities where they're working in a pair or a group, right? We need to make students very clearly accountable for their grades, for their marks. We can always help them. Normally what I do with my students is if I'm giving an assignment, I ask them to write a draft and show me the draft. If they're working individually, if they're working in pairs or in groups, I tend to do that. And normally what happens in such cases is that the student answers after they've prepared one draft and I've corrected the draft. They feel that, oh, she's, ma'am is serious about her work. So they will work on the second draft or on the third draft because they feel motivated to get a particular grade in the class. Also, another aspect which is important and which I do is giving them a rubric. Rubric means... I tell them before, in the beginning of the semester, for a particular course, that these are the grades that the university gives. O grade, A plus, A, B, B plus. And I tell them, this is what you are supposed to do if you are going to get an O grade. Your answers should be logically clear. They should be coherent. They should have this kind of a word limit. You should cite your sources very clearly. Your argument should be clear. So they know that for O grade, this is what they are expected to do. For A plus grade, this is what they are expected to do. So once we creating a rubric takes time initially, but once we've created that rubric, we can keep using it for every semester, for every course. And the rubric helps because the students are also clear, because students then feel that, you know, our marking is not partial as teachers. We are just. We have already told them that this is what you have to do. And at the university level, also at the school level, this is something we encourage, that they should not cheat their answers. They should not copy their answers from different places. So once we prepare a rubric, things become a little clearer. Then, these are some of the aids which I feel that can help us apart from developing teaching, particular effective teaching attitudes. These are some of the aids that I feel that help us psychologically to think and to behave in the classroom and to understand our students. First one is something which is called self-serving bias. Self-serving bias in psychology means that when we tell a student that, oh, you know, you are average. I don't expect much from you. You can only do this much. Over time, if we say this once, twice, thrice, repeatedly, the student will start believing that. Mm-hmm. So as teachers, we always need to say, even though your answer is this, but I believe that you're very intelligent. So you should work hard. So once the student starts feeling that they are intelligent, even if they are dull, they will work hard. This is just a small aid to teaching, to understand our students. Another is the tone, the affective tone is the emotional tone that we maintain in the class. As teachers, we need to be friendly, but we also need to be very assertive. We need to be clear to create a boundary in the classroom as school teachers, as college teachers, university teachers, that we are friends with you, yes, but you have to take classroom teaching seriously. Their questions, their curiosity can be encouraged. Mm-hmm. But again, we need to be very clear that our tone is healthy. The students, because of our tone, the students should not be adversely affected. Humor is again a very important aspect. I often joke in my classes, in when I give them breaks, or even when I'm explaining something, I joke in the class often. Sometimes when I'm, this is something that I do personally in my class. Sometimes when I am teaching a concept, I will explain it technically. And once I've explained it technically and I've asked them, have you understood? I will crack a joke about it. So then the students will laugh and smile, and then I'll say, you have to understand the concept, but don't take things very seriously. Don't become tense. Okay. The other point is certain psychological processes. We need to understand things like the anxiety level of our students. Do they, as we teach, we are able to assess and understand. Are these students, do they expect too much out of themselves? Are they lazy? Are they the anxious type? Are they the aggressive types? Will they speak too much in the class? Are they the mischief creators? Are they very serious? Right? When we tend to understand these psychological processes, one way of understanding them is using student interest surveys. The other one is using emotion-based surveys. Now, if we can't use surveys are actually ask, putting questions to them. Do you talk too much? What interests you? Do you get angry? When do you get angry? Questions like these, simple questions like these, right? And we can ask them to fill this, and we can hold maybe one class out of the whole semester or two classes to understand this. But even if we cannot do a complete survey, right? Sometimes in the class, we should take 5 minutes to talk to them about this. To talk to them about their emotions, about the way they think. Also, one important psychological process that I want to share with you all is a process which is called sublimation. Sublimation means making something unacceptable acceptable. So often students, one typical example is, often students are envious of each other. And competition does not remain healthy. So we should talk to students about this. Ask them indirect questions, or directly if we can talk to them. Talk to them in the class or even outside the class, right? So we can address those issues so that the student can actually pay attention to learning and understand. Another aspect is scaffolding. Scaffolding is a concept that comes from the work of this very famous Russian theorist Vygotsky. And scaffolding just means that students can often do things independently, and we should encourage them. But at the same time, as teachers, we should know that there are some things that they can do better with our help. So one way in which I often scaffold students is when I want them to work hard and get good grades, you know, for one small chapter or something, I might explain to them sample answers. This is what I expect you to do. This is the way you're supposed to write. This is the introduction. This is the conclusion. These are some of the points you should include. And I do it from one lesson in their class. And then I tell them, now apply, try and apply these concepts to the other lessons that we're doing. So for one lesson, I do it, I scaffold them. And then why I tell them to do it for the other lessons. They might falter, they might need my help again, but surely they get an idea of how they are supposed to answer, either orally or in terms of writing. Another aspect that I want to share with you is something which is called metacognition and memory. Now, metacognition means thinking about thinking. So one of the most important activities which I feel for teachers is when we want students to understand and we don't have time to, you know, make them write, too much syllabus has to be completed, too many things we have to do and time is running short. So sometimes when we want to assess them, we should ask them, explain the lesson and then ask them, what do you think about the lesson? Actually, what we're asking them to do is summarize. That is, make a summary. But we should not use the word summary. We should ask them, so what is this whole thing about? What do you understand by this scientific experiment? What do you understand by this chapter in history? What were the causes? What were the effects? Right? Tell me in short. So what we're asking them to do is, when they're listening to you, they're thinking, right? Now, when we're asking them to summarize, they're thinking about the thinking process. And that would be a very important aid in learning, in understanding. Another aspect is memory. Most of the research on memory says that our short-term memory, like I mentioned earlier, is little. Students have shorter attention spans. Psycholinguistically or psychologically, we can hold the student's attention for 45 minutes to 50 minutes, not more than that, right? So how is it that we should make them remember things? How is it that we can ease the learning process? I often use a concept for memory which is called chunking. Chunking just means grouping. So when I've taught a concept to them, I group the concept and I say, these are the effects, these are the causes, and this is the process, or these are the features, right? And I also create something which is called a mnemonic. Mnemonic means make a word out of all those causes or effects. Give them a letter each, EAPS or something like that. And say, now you remember this and you'll remember these points. So students who are good at memorizing will remember them either ways. Students who are a little average or dull, they will thank us. Why? Because we've helped them in learning. We've helped them in memorizing. Chunking helps. Another aspect is asking students to group things under one heading. Like one example is, you know, when we often teach children about animals, we tell them that this is a cat, this is a dog, this is an elephant. We don't tell them the different kinds of dogs when they are young. When they're growing up, then they get to know that, you know, we have a Pomeranian, we have a Labrador, right? We have a Tibetan Mastiff. We have different kinds of Lhasa Apso. We have different kinds of dogs. This is also a part of memory and learning. When students find things difficult, when they find concepts difficult, we should tell them, make a heading in your rough copy and put these points, put them under it. This would help them to remember, memorize that, oh, this chapter had these many points. So at the end of it, they do not, when students look at the chapters, they don't feel, oh God, we have to learn so much, prepare so much. If we can aid them in learning, in remembering, they would be thankful, obviously, and they'd be a little more attentive in the class because they know that we are simplifying their work for them. Then, we now come to the psychology of the student, how the student functions, what they understand. So this is a very small diagram that I've drawn here, which most of us as teachers understand. Their thoughts, feelings motivate their behaviors. And their behavior is motivated by reinforcement. Reinforcement means either it can be positive, that is, they are positively appreciated for something, or it can be negative. They understand that they don't have to do it. And again, reinforcement affects their thinking, what they have to do and what they don't have to do. So through our teaching attitudes, I feel, and through our psychological aids that I've discussed, we can affect and also change the psychology of the student by talking to them, by interacting with them inside the class and outside the class. These are some of the student attitudes that students feel. And here, a point that I had mentioned earlier that I would talk about motivation, here is when I would talk about motivation. Students have different motivations to attend a class. Some students obviously feel that they are forced to sit in a class and they are not interested, right? But we can develop different kinds of motivations for them. One is something which is called instrumental motivation. Instrumental motivation means you are doing something to get a particular objective done. So you want to learn English because you want to go abroad and teach. That is instrumental. But integrative motivation means you are doing something because you think it's great for you, because you're interested in it. So you want to learn English because, or you want to learn another language like Japanese, right? Or Russian, because you want to go and experience their culture. Or even in India, you want to understand their cuisine, their language. That is integrative. As teachers, we are always straddling between these two. How to develop instrumental motivation and integrative motivation. Normally for students I've seen, we can motivate them on the basis of their values and their reactions. That is, what are their goals? What are their interests? How are they oriented to a task? For example, for any task, students will understand the task and approach the task on the basis of four factors. Their ability, the kind of effort they would put in, how difficult the task is, and the factor of luck. Now, if the student is interested in a particular task, our work gets easier. But if they're not interested in task, we need to give them some kind of incentive, which is again instrumental motivation. Do this so you know you can work hard on this particular test, right? And you'd get this kind of a grade. Or even integrative motivation, that don't worry about your marks, right? Just try and understand this concept. One way in which we can build integrative motivation is nowadays, students often use technology, a factor that I mentioned below here. For us as teachers, technology is a useful accompaniment. But for students, technology nowadays is they're so exposed to technology that it is literally their partner. Most students that I come across, you know, if I, as an English teacher, when I ask them that, please check this out, it is normally expected that they would go to the library, look at the encyclopedia, or check the word out in the dictionary. But they would not do this. Nowadays, they would just open their phone, go to Google Chrome, check the information, and give me more information about it. So we need to use technology positively with them to motivate them to learn. Often what I do is, I tell them, this is how I've explained the topic, and I explain it partially. And then I ask them, can you add something more about this? Do you know something more about this? Or I'll tell them some story that, you know, this is something that I'd heard about it. Is this true? So I have picked their interests. Some of them would be curious. Even the ones who do not want to study will be a little curious. And so they'll be motivated to go on the net, search, read something about it. Then I might ask them, okay, I'll complete this chapter. And maybe you can, you know, get me a write-up on this, or get me a video, you know, or a clipping. So they will use the net constructively and get that, because technology is a partner for them, right? So this way I am teaching in the class, I am finishing my syllabus on time, but I'm also bringing in technology. I'm also trying to motivate them. Another aspect is how physically comfortable they feel in a particular classroom. Often as teachers, you know, we demand a lot of attention from our students. but we should not. We also need to understand that they're students. They will fidget. They will be a little impatient in the class. They will talk a little. So some little bit of talking in the class, 2 minutes, 3 minutes, 5 minutes is allowed. Right? As long as they are not speaking, they're giving full attention to when you are lecturing. Students will tend to talk when you are writing something on the blackboard. They will tend to do that. Right? Also, so we need to be a little lenient about that aspect. Not extremely lenient, because then they will take us lightly, but a little lenient. Another aspect is something that I'd like to share with you is they're giving them feedback and creating grids. Now, this is a grid that I've created. And this works for all kinds of subjects. Obviously, as teachers of different subjects in history, geography, economics, physics, chemistry, mathematics, different things, English, we can, or Hindi, we can, or any of our other vernacular languages like Telugu, we can change the grid. But this is a general grid where we ask, where I ask the students, what's the history? What's the cause? Tell me some of the features. And since I teach at the university level, I also ask them, where did you get this information from? Traditional sources means, did you read a book? Did you consult something? And I often say, you know, you'll get a better grade if you've read from a book, all right? And you can cite it and tell me. So they're motivated to go to the library sometimes. Alternative sources means using multimedia, using the internet. And then there are different assignment modes, different modes, like what are we focusing on in the classroom? Normally, as teachers, we tend to focus on long answers or short answers, right? But as teachers, we should explore other modes also, like narrative, storytelling is an interesting mode, right? Even essay writing is a very good mode. So this is one grid which I use with my students. Another aspect is, before I come to language and psychology, one aspect that I'd like to share with you on feedback. There is a lot of debate about feedback in learning and in research. Some teachers and researchers say that feedback should be sparingly given. That is, we should not correct the student every time. Some say that we should, depending on what we are trying to teach them. Right? In my experience, I have realized that often when a student is speaking, we know as teachers from their reaction, from their body language, are they very interested in the topic or are they just giving the answer? If they are very interested in a topic, we should allow the student to speak. Even if they are saying something incorrect, we should often listen to what they're saying. Once they've spoken, right, we can make mental notes and tell them, this is where you were wrong. This is what you should have said. And you can improve this for your next answer. Right? Or something that I do with my classes when I'm short of time. I might teach several topics, right? And after those several topics, I might say that I'm holding two classes for discussions. So I've finished a major part of my syllabus, but I hold two classes for discussions. I often ask them to read and come to the class. Some students will read, most students will not read. But before I begin my discussion, I do a quick recap that we are going to discuss this topic. And if you remember, I had spoken this, 4 or 5 basic points. And then I ask my questions, right? I might ask them to answer, write the answers, right? Give them 5-10 minutes to write the answers. And then I ask them to speak. Now, often what happens in such a situation is, there will be some students who will try and answer very well. Some of them would not try and answer well. The ones who do not try and answer well, either I attend to them individually or I listen to all the answers, as many answers as are there in that particular section or for that particular lesson or class. And then towards the end of the class, for 10 minutes, 15 minutes, I tell them, now I'm telling you the general mistakes made by everybody. So I don't point fingers at students. I don't tell them that you said this and you said that. Sometimes I do that, but sometimes I do a general understanding where I tell them, this is what you should do. This is how you should answer. This is how you can improve. Don't put this in the answer. You can use this for your presentation. So the ones, they are intelligent enough to understand that these are the mistakes I made and I should not be making this. So at the end of it, it ensures that the students do get better grades. If they do not get very good or excellent grades, they do get better grades. Over time, they do become better. Now, we've covered the aspect of students and their psychology, teachers and their psychology and effective aids and their attitudes. Now we come to the third segment, which is on language and psychology. This part is the kind of language which is used by us as teachers and the kind of language which is used by students for a healthy classroom dynamics or for healthy classroom management. One of the very basic things is conversational rules. As teachers, we need to decide and create these boundaries very clearly. Who's asking the questions in the class? Who's answering? Who's interrupting? We need to focus on these aspects. Why? Because often as teachers, we ask questions and students tend to answer. But we can also reverse. They can ask questions and we can answer. We can clarify their doubts. Right? Also, we need to set boundaries on interruption. I often tend to do this, that as a general rule, my students know that when I'm explaining a concept, they are not supposed to interrupt me, even if they have questions. Once I've explained the concept, they can interrupt me. So I will not explain a concept and speak continuously for 40 minutes. I will speak for 5 minutes, 10 minutes, then pause. They can ask me and interrupt me at that point of time. Speak then. So who is asking the questions, who is answering, and who is interrupting? Also, the general classroom conduct. When are they given permissions and for what reasons are they given permissions in the class? How many people, this is a very common thing that we face as teachers, you know. Sometimes students, when they become a little older, adolescent, teenage group, they tend to ask permissions to go to the bathroom or the washroom when actually they do not want to attend the class. So this is a very funny thing that I do in my class. Three students can go to the washroom, right? And the rest of them, I jokingly say that let these three students come back, let them loiter around and come back. And then you three, the other two, three of you can go. So they know very clearly that ma'am is not going to let them leave the class. So giving them permissions for what kind of thing? When is interaction allowed in the classroom? That's another aspect. They will talk amongst themselves. When is it that as teachers, we say, now you can talk? When I'm doing a group activity, a pair activity, or sometimes when I'm asking a question also, and I know that they will not individually give an answer to this. I ask the question and then I say, you can discuss. Take half a minute, discuss with your friends, give me an answer. Once they discuss, I know that they've talked it out with each other. So some of them will give the answer. So when is interaction allowed in the classroom? When is it not? Also breaks. As teachers, in the school, the period is for 45 to 50 minutes, then obviously we cannot give a formal break. We can lighten the mood of the class in between, but we cannot give formal breaks. But if the session is long, if it's a 1 hour class, we can teach for half an hour and give a 2 minutes break, 3 minutes break to them, because they cannot pay attention. It's humanly, psychologically not possible for a student to pay attention for such a long time. So breaks need to be given. One aspect that I've often found in breaks is sometimes when I want my students to pay attention and I don't want them to leave the class, I give a break, but I tell them a story. Something randomly about something which I know will interest them, their age group. I tell them something. So some of them will not leave. They will insist. They will not even use their phones. They will sit in the class. And sometimes this technique has worked so well that some of my students actually say that, ma'am, in this break, we will ask you this question about this aspect. So breaks are a little important. Either we give them a formal break or lighten the mood somehow. The other aspect is gender dynamics. Gender dynamics is often as teachers, research shows us that we pay attention to this concept, which is called salience. Salience means whoever is talking more in the class, okay, we somehow feel that they are very intelligent and bright. They are participating. But this might not be the case every time. Some students might be quiet, even though they know. Some students might be quiet because they are shy. Some of them will be quiet because they don't know, right? And we need to focus on the boys and girls in our classroom equally. We cannot have a situation where more boys are talking and less girls are talking, or vice versa, where more girls are talking and the boys are not getting a chance to speak. This sometimes happens even with the kind of language we use in our classes. Especially, I've seen one incident that I'll tell you about, again, my schooling with one of my maths teachers. Even though I have studied in a convent, but my maths teacher was very encouraging. But sometimes he would turn around and say that, you know, you would not be able to understand this concept. You would not be able to understand this concept. So students sometimes would, after the class, discuss this concept. So as teachers, we need to be very mindful of our language, of what we are saying. If we as teachers say that, you know, a particular gender cannot understand this, we are in some way discriminating on the basis of gender, which we should not. Also, we need to use gender-neutral language in the classroom. Many a times we tend to say, you know, he, his, him, very often, right? We associate genders with particular professions. Traditionally, stereotypically, we tend to say doctors and engineers are males, right? Nurses will be women, teachers will be women. But this is not the case. In today's day and age, we see both genders doing both kinds of things, right? So our language needs to have more of they, them, their, rather than focusing on one of the genders. Some more aspects related to language. One aspect is the concept of speech acts. Speech acts means how we use language to perform particular actions in the classroom. This means that I might, if I say this, one example, I might go to a friend of mine and say, I really need 5,000 rupees. What am I actually doing? I am requesting or asking for 5,000 rupees, right? Or if my mother comes inside the room and says, shut the door, what is she doing? She might be requesting, but the way she is saying it, it seems that she is ordering, right? So speech acts are language used to perform certain actions. As teachers, we need to be mindful of the speech acts that we use. And we also need to tell our students the kind of speech acts that they can use. For example, acknowledging, requesting, justifying, you know, justification in the sense of answering, how students frame their answers, the arguments that they give for it. Okay, are speech acts that we should encourage. Accusing, ordering, mocking, these acts we should not encourage in the classroom. So there are particular ways of saying things. One way is we should also, as teachers, whatever subject we are teaching, but we as teachers should tell students that, you know, you've said this, you can also say it this way. This is a more polite way of saying it. So some students tend to say that, you know, can I do this? I often tell my students, you can say, can I do this? But you can also say, may I do this? So I'm correcting their speech acts, right? Another aspect is the use of impoliteness strategies. Impoliteness, there are 4 or 5 impoliteness strategies mentioned here. One is exclusion. Knowingly or unknowingly excluding a particular student from the class, even though the student is in the class. Exclusion does not happen only at the level of, you know, telling the student that you would not be able to do this, or this is the way you are. Exclusion also happens when the student loses interest, right? Another aspect is physical space. We are sometimes as teachers with particular students, we be irritated. After all, we are also human beings, right? And some students can really try our patience. Even when that happens and we are irritated with the students, we need to know that there is a kind of physical spatial distance that we need to maintain from the student. Okay, why? Because it might aggravate the situation, one. And two, there might be another set of students who are the anxious type, who might get frightened by the way we are talking or the way we are behaving. physically, if we get closer to them and talk. Another aspect is frightening or warning them. That is also considered very impolite. Okay. If you don't do this, you won't be able to pass the test. If you don't do this, you'll fail the exam. It doesn't make sense. As teachers, we should avoid this kind of language. We should not frighten them for consequences. And we should always be mindful of the way we are speaking to them in terms of addressing them and their identity. So we should always use appropriate identity markers. Like, we cannot address them by their surnames. We should also always address them by their first names. We cannot do name calling. We cannot comment on their appearance, on the way they are, because before, even if we want to do that, we should do that outside the class or personally to them, but not in front of their peers, because students will take it very harshly. They will find that action and that language very, very rude. Two more points are: we need to be mindful and careful about our pronunciation. Most of the time I've seen students are very curious to know how as teachers we pronounce things, or how we use language, or how we tend to look at particular concepts. So pronunciation and paying attention to pronunciation is very important. Often I have heard students and seen students who make fun of teachers, you know, in the way they speak. So if we pay attention to our pronunciation, students tend to feel that, you know, oh, this teacher knows, oh, this teacher tends to pay attention, this teacher is serious about what they're saying. And this last point is about contextual background versus trivia. Often what I do is, in my classes, this is a small activity that I do. Before I give them something to write on or something to speak about, or before I announce a test, okay, I switch between these two aspects. If the topic is serious and demands a lot of attention, I will give a contextual background to it. This is how this happened. This is how it developed. These are the aspects. This is the way we define a concept scientifically. This is the reason why we are defining it this way, right? This is the classification for it, etc. Or sometimes I just give trivia. Like, I will speak, even though I'm an English teacher, sometimes I speak about scientists or some work done by some historian, or something about, you know, what we can see in terms of geographical space or something like that. Totally irrelevant information. Tell them some trivia and then come to the task at hand. That is to just get their attention for 2-3 minutes. Okay. Sometimes I also do another exercise. If I have to talk about my topic, that is, let's say I am a teacher of English language, but sometimes I teach specialized courses in literature. So if I'm talking about a concept in literature, like a poem, and I want to talk about the poet, so I can either give the background of the poet, or I can give some trivia, some totally not so relevant information about the poet. That, did you know when this poet was young, this is how this poet used to behave, or this is how the poet used to write? Something related to that. And the students would sit up. They would pay attention. So as teachers, we need to play between these two aspects to bring their attention back in the class. It is our job as teachers to always keep working to get their attention back and to keep motivating them, so that they pay attention. Now, here I have some of the resources. I'm sure you've had excellent webinars and sessions where the teachers, the resource persons have, you know, shared different resources with you. But these are some of the resources that I feel can be used by you. Either these are resources that have lesson plans. Some of them are printable. Some of them have exercises. Some of them have different kinds of multimedia that you can use. There is one very interesting one on the second one, google.com, the Earth. This I feel is very important for teachers who are teaching geography, but even for teachers otherwise, to begin a discussion in the classroom. There are some that I've collected on mathematics, on social studies, on different areas. So I hope this can be of use to you. So that is all that I had to say. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Soumya Sharma. It's a wonderful session we have witnessed today.
Thank you.
So most of here today, we started off our session with 53 participants. Now we reached up to 97 participants. Really, it's a very good number. Really wonderful presentation, and it is most of the participants are teachers, especially language teachers. And I personally feel it is, you have just introduced the refreshing course of psychology for all of us, and even it is not exaggerating to say that it is quite relevant to the teachers who are teaching the 21st century students. So you just introduced us the new trends, and it's a modern psychology to all of us. Really, we are very grateful to accepting
Thank
your
you.
Invitation. Now, I would like to let Madam. Would you like to take a few questions? From
Yes, sure.
Now, I request participants to raise your hands to have any questions to ask Soumya Madam. Please raise your hands. We will allow you three to five participants. Please raise your hands. Okay. Arogya Raj, sir. Yes, now you unmute yourself and ask your question to the madam. To madam, okay? Please.
May I ask a question to you?
Yes. Yes, please.
Good evening, good evening.
I can hear you.
Good evening, madam.
Good evening.
Ma'am,
good evening.
Sir, ma'am, myself, sorry. Rajesh Kumar Pandey from Kolkata.
Okay. Yes.
Rajesh Kumar, sir, please wait a minute. I have Arogya Raj, sir, first.
Okay, sir.
Next, okay. I'll come to
you. Good evening, madam. I'm talking from Nizamabad, madam, from English teacher from Nizamabad.
Yes.
Madam, I'm teaching from 6th class to 10th class. So, madam, the problem is that in rural background, in rural areas, students are, you told all this, sometimes students are not putting concentration, even though we try our level best.
Yes.
Whatever the activity that you have told, we are doing our level best. But we don't get proper response from the children, even though we do a lot of hard work. Please give response, madam. Please.
Okay, sir, what subject are you teaching?
I'm teaching English, madam. Some people have a lot of joy of learning, but some people, 50% of the people. So how can we motivate them? Just we need some.
Okay. Sir, there are two things that I feel from what I've discussed, because this is a problem that I faced with some of my students. I've been facing that, and even now I faced it earlier also when I began my career, and even now I face some students like this. Sir, two things help a lot. One is those student-based surveys that I spoke about. We don't need to create a survey. If you can actually create a small survey, ask them certain, write down the questions, get it printed on a sheet and ask and give it to them, and then discuss in the class, right? So one class maybe, or two classes, even, because we have to complete our syllabus, so we need to focus on the class, but one or two classes sometimes we can hold where we are just talking to them.
I have doubt.
Yes. So if we have these kind of surveys or questions or discussions with them, even the dull students, even students who don't have any interest, respond in these classes. Because they feel that, this is not just teaching any longer. Something else is happening in the class. Another thing that helps with these students is talking to them outside the class, sir. Because some of these students, like some of the times I have noticed students, they come from different backgrounds and they have different family problems and different issues. Yes, so when I address these issues outside the class, over time, my students always realize that this teacher is friendly. So whatever personal problems I have, I can discuss with this person. Now, once they get that confidence, they will also gradually start respecting you and start feeling that, no, this teacher is putting effort in the class. I need to pay attention to the class also. So sometimes we need to look at academics and then the behavior. Sometimes we need to look at the behavior first and then come to academics. So it depends
on the student.
Yes.
Yeah, I understood, madam. Yeah, good. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Was excellent, madam. Session was excellent. Thank you.
Thank you, Arogya Raj, sir. And now, before I go to Govardhan Reddy, sir, I am pleased to invite Mr. Rajesh Kumar, sir.
Sir, yes, please. Yes.
Ma'am, myself Rajesh Kumar Pandey.
Yes.
The problem is with me that I have always faced large classes where more than 120, 130 students are there.
Okay.
So this creates a problem, particularly in teaching grammar and the correction. How will I solve it?
Okay. Sir, this is you have been teaching English language, sir? English grammar?
Yeah.
So, sir, two, three points I can suggest maybe. One is, sir, when you teach grammar, move around in the class. Don't use the blackboard too much.
Okay, I do.
One is move around a lot because the backbenchers always feel, oh, you know, the teacher is going to be there in the front. So I can do whatever I want to do. When you move around, you know, something I do in my class, when I have a huge class, I'll give you the example from IIT Kanpur. I was a guest faculty. IIT Kanpur actually wanted somebody to teach their students English. I'm talking some years back. Why? Because their students, this is their request, their students were able to crack all the scientific exams. They were able to do everything. They were very good in their subjects, but they could not get job placements because their English was poor. So I was chosen as a guest faculty and I went there to teach. Now the class size, sir, was 500 students in one session. Now, and I was teaching them grammar, composition, communication skills. So what I used to do was, these students were big tall boys. And I am not as tall as a tall boy, right? But so I would make it a point to use the blackboard, but then I would get down on the stage still, and then I would walk in the class. And when I would walk in the class, some student would be doodling or doing something. I would catch hold of that and ask the student, why don't you explain this concept to me? So one or two classes of students realized she's going to walk around and teach. So they had to put their mobile phones away. They had to pay attention. Second thing, when we teach grammar, one very important aspect in grammar is, sir, this requires a little bit of effort, but it works. Mostly when we teach grammar, we have rule, grammar rule and example. We should do it the other way around. We can sometimes pick a story, right? Or some incident. Make all kinds of grammar problems there in that incident or story, in printable sheet, and give it to the students. And then teach the concept that these are a few rules. Write them rules on the board, some 3-4 rules, not too many to bog the children down, right? And then say, what do you find wrong in the story? How can we improve it? Can you tell me something about it? Then grammar classes are not boring for the students. Then they are able to pay attention because they feel, and when we choose our stories or topics, we should choose those topics which the students find interesting. So when, for example, when I teach grammar in my university, I often take up very, very strong topics. I will take up topics like addiction. You know, a lot of students, youngsters face this problem, addiction to social media. You know, or I would take up topics like, you know, sleeping disorders. Some students, you know, I'm sure you know, in universities and colleges, they stay up till late and then they get up also late and they don't attend morning classes. So I take up topics that where I can help them. So I'm not only teaching them grammar, they are not only correcting the language, but I'm also giving them psychological advice in the class. So that also helps. Sometimes English literature stories help. We can take a story, type it out or download it from the net, use incorrect grammar there, and then introduce a topic. I hope this helps, sir.
Yeah, yes. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Three more people are there.
Sure.
Can I speak? Can I speak?
1 minute. I invite Govardhan.
Lakshman Samap by 8:30.
Right.
Sir, I'm Govardhan.
Yeah, go on there. Govardhan, sir, please say in brief.
Sir, good evening, madam. As Lakshman sir said that you have taught a psychological and philosophical basis of the language and how to teach by understanding the students. But as we know that no method is perfect.
Yes, totally.
No method is perfect, no method is wrong, no method is right. Okay, and while teaching, I am a primary school teacher. While teaching, I have applied all the methods what you have explained just now, and I succeed somewhat else. I will teach in a rural background school, and what you said that roaming around the here and there and observing the body language and understanding the emotional backgrounds of the students. And I sum up the just now one of our participants said that, but while teaching the grammar, we are facing so many problems. As you said, this is a paradigm shift. How to teach? Set of rules. Actually, we could not teach the language by teaching a set of rules.
Yes, but there is another aspect.
But without rules also, we cannot master the language. Can you give some intermediate solution?
Yes, so there has to be an intermediate solution for this. Because like you said, no method is perfect. And as teachers, you know, as a teacher, only you know or I know what will work in my class, right? So for intermediate teaching, one of the two things that I said was, you know, the using stories or using topics that are related to them and then using incorrect language and then asking them to correct it. Another aspect that I said, teach very few rules, very basic rules. Like, for example, if you're teaching present tense or past tense. Now, present tense itself is divided into further tense. Present perfect, present continuous, this, that. So we only teach the basic idea to the student. Present continuous, you only use here. Present perfect, you use here. Present perfect continuous, you use here. That's it. Not all the rules. Right? This is one aspect. The other aspect is use reading in the classroom. Reading. Lots of reading. Speaking.
Right.
If they can't write, ask them to read. Read in the class. On a particular topic, speak about a particular topic, right? Sometimes what happens when you ask them to speak about a particular topic, every time, sir, when we have big classes, we can't ask everybody to speak. But in 20, 30, 40 classes, we can at least ask all the class members or more than half the class people to speak. And every time, different people, not the same people, right? So this is something that we can do with grammar. Because grammar, one aspect of grammar which research says is we should not teach rules at all. But this is something I don't believe in. Because I agree with you, some rules have to be taught. Students cannot be without rules completely. So some rules have to be given, but very basic rules. Very, very basic rules. Yes.
Thank you, madam. Yes. Thanks for giving your lucid answering. And due to time paucity, we are unable to invite other participants to for the question hour. Now, today we have a few important guests in the session. Professor Ravinarayan Chakrakudi is also there in the session. Really, we are very fortunate. He is the director of RIE Bangalore. Sir, please reflect briefly upon this session. Hello. Hello. Right.
Hello.
I think Sar has left the session. Anyway, today really we could conduct this session without interruption.
3:25, no?
Yeah. Right. So without interruption for 1 hour 25 minutes, it was. Possible due to one good and generous person who is behind us for the past 7 to 8 webinars. He is none other than Professor Rajasekhar Vangapati. He sponsored the link from New App. Now I would like to invite Professor Rajasekhar Vangapati to address the gathering. Hello?
Professor, sir?
Sir,
are you there?
So actually, he said he would join. Okay, if he joins again, we will ask him. Now, before we go to conclude the session, I would like to invite our General Secretary Vinayadhar Raju reflect upon the session very briefly. Hello, Vinayadhar Raju.
Thank you. Hello, Lakshman and everybody, yes. And thank you, ma'am, for.
providing a very informative Thank session you. For us, and most of the teachers are doing the things, but the doing things is not important, continuing things is important. So after attending this webinar, the teachers will go and start doing one thing and they will not get the results, they will stop doing it. So doing things for about a year, 2 years will get you a different perceptions of that, and that will solve the problem. So that is the thing that we have to address. And we also thank for everyone and everybody. They are repeatedly attending our webinars. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinay. Thanks a lot. And before we invite Asha Purna to express our vote of thanks, I would like to invite our state president, ELTA, T. Venkateshwar Rao, to reflect upon this session.
Good evening, ma'am. Good evening, all. Really, it is awesome presentation. You made us spellbound with your presentation. You. Really, it's very useful, and it's really apt at the situation. And we need to practice the method that you have told. You have shared with us all this time, and really, ELTA, thank you very much. Accept our sincere gratitude for spending almost 1.5 hours time hours with us and giving valuable guidelines regarding usage of psychology. Really, thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Lakshman, ask the Asha Tipan.
Asha, just please don't mind here. Small change regarding the vote of thanks here.
Sir, Professor Sir has come, I think.
Yeah.
Professor Sir is
there. Yes, yes.
He's there.
Yeah.
Let us invite.
No problem.
Sir, Professor Rajshekhar Sir has just joined our session. Now I would like to invite Professor Rajshekhar Sir, who has been encouraging to conduct this uninterrupted sessions for the last 15 days. Without him, it would not have been possible. So I would like to invite Rajshekhar Sir to reflect upon this session. Over to Rajshekhar Sir.
Good evening, and everybody. This is Professor Rajshekhar from New York. Thank you for giving me the opportunity. Wonderful. I'm sorry I could not attend the meeting, but definitely it must be very interesting and educative for all the teachers. I'm happy that I could able to provide some platform for you all to conduct the uninterrupted sessions. That's wonderful. So wish you all good luck. I cannot really judge anything on this one. Definitely the presenter must be done a wonderful job. So Lakshman, over to you.
Thank you very much, sir, for joining. Really, without your support, we would have not conducted this kind of uninterrupted sessions. We are indebted to you, and we expect the same support in future. Thank you very much, sir. And now I would like to invite.
I just wanted to tell one thing.
Yeah.
The psychology is not taught to us. I was actually graduate from Engineering Usmania University, and I did my master's in IIT also. During that time, there is no psychology subject in our education in the college levels. Unfortunately, that is, I don't know how they missed it, the UK system, our Queen's method of methodology we follow. But in this country, when I came to US, the psychology is a part and parcel of the whole education system here, even from the high schools and also. Plus, even the colleges, if you don't actually get through the psychology subject, you don't graduate from the bachelor's degree here in this country. So it's a part of the psychology and sociology is one of the key courses one has to complete to graduate from the bachelor's program. Whether it could be medicine, it could be engineering, or it could be law, it doesn't matter. But the question is the subject completed or not? Psychology, sociology, and some American history, and some general education component. That's why the difference between India bachelor's degree and US bachelor's degree is a 4 years degree is called a bachelor's degree in US, and India we call 3 years degree is a bachelor's degree. So the difference between that 1 year time here in US, what they study all the subjects of the general education. General education comes with the math, science, plus how to behave with your colleagues, how to behave with your students and the peers. And once you go to the job, actually, so how do you behave with those people also? So the, all these components, actually, you learn while you are in studying in the bachelor's degree level. So that's the important point. The madam must have covered all these things. So the important point, I think you all should understand how to treat your class. So that all matters as a teacher. So that's what actually I learned after coming back from India. When I started teaching here, I learned as a student and as a teacher also. So there's a lot of difference where we really understand relationship between a student and a teacher. So I hope, when you come across any psychology subject between the teacher and the student, you should really keep focus on that one. So wish all good luck once again, and then we'll catch up in the next session, I think. Take care.
Thank you, Professor, sir. Really, it's a wonderful concluding words. Thank you very much.
Lakshman. So Shashidhar Bandu, day after Tumas, plenary speaker is also there, and I request Shashidhar Bandu to talk about the session.
Vinayadhar Garu, do you expect me to speak right away?
Yeah, right.
Everyone, I'll be dealing with techniques and tools for an engaging class on 21st. And I hope most of you have attended some of my sessions. I'll be introducing some new tools. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now, I would like to invite Kalyani Reddy to say a vote of thanks. Okay, please, Kalyani Reddy, ma'am, over to you.
Yes, sir. Good evening, all. I think I'm really honored to have been asked to propose vote of thanks in such wonderful session. On behalf of ELTA Telangana, I would like to thank Dr. Soumya Sharma, Assistant Professor EFLO, Lucknow, for taking up such wonderful session on psychology in classrooms. Ma'am, I think you have really inspired us, and you have triggered us to think of the out of the box, ma'am. The activities that you do in your classrooms are so good that we definitely would like to take them into our classrooms. And the aids such as self-serving bias, effective tone and humor, etc., are really quite new and innovative to us, ma'am. Thanks for introducing us to such new aids. And we hope that would really aid us to transact the class very well. In a nutshell, ma'am, I would like to say that it was just a detour to think in a different way and make a happy learning to our kids, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. And we look forward to more such wonderful sessions from you. I would also like to thank Professor Raj Vangapati for providing us a free platform to us. And my heartfelt thanks to Venkateshwara sir, President ELTA Telangana, and then Vinaydar Raju sir, General Secretary ELTA Telangana, coordinators Lakshman sir and Sampath sir, for taking initiative to schedule such wonderful sessions. I would also like to thank all the wonderful knowledge seekers who are a part of this session today. Hope you have enriched yourself with many new strategies. Thank you all. Over to Lakshman sir.
Thank you, Kalyani madam. Thank you very much for expressing vote of thanks on behalf of ELTA Telangana.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Soumya madam. Would you like to say anything before we conclude?
No. I just want to say I hope the session was useful, and please keep practicing, because like I say, in classroom as teachers, only we know what's going to work in the classroom. Theory and research is important, yes, but most of this research, I'd like to say, is, you know, done from a Western perspective in education and in English. And even though research is being done in India, but more research needs to be done. So we need to adapt and understand and modify the concepts that are used in the West for our own children, and so that we can teach effectively. We cannot just take those concepts from there and apply them directly. It doesn't work.
in our context, in our classrooms, with our students and their backgrounds, it doesn't work. So we keep trying new things. Something or the other will work in the classroom. So happy teaching to all of you. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, madam.
Thank you.
Let us
thank you, madam.
In future thank you. Also, thank you, madam.
Yes.
Thanks to all the participants.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now,
thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, all of you. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you. Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you,
ma'am. Thank you. Thank you a lot, madam.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, all of you.
Thank you,
madam. Wonderful. Wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all of you.
Thank you all of you.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you all of
Hello.
Our experiences. Thank you very much for sharing.
Thank you.
Your experiences with us.
Thank you very much for all of you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Hello. Hello.
Vinay.
Okay. Shall I ask Professor Sir to end the session?
Yeah.
Sir.
One minute. Regarding tomorrow's and day after tomorrow's.
Sir has left. I suppose. Professor sir has left.
Professor, are you there?
He's there.
Professor?
No. Yeah, he's there, but he must have gone from his seat. Now, okay, he's...
You talk to him personally.
Yeah. I'll make a call to him after this session. So, I request all the other participants, please leave as early as possible so that we can end the session. So, being co-host, we must be anchor.
As a host, you can end the
meeting. Sir, end the meeting.
Only host can end. Okay, right.
Yeah, only host can end. We can't.